Hello students, let us study the concept consideration. So this is an important element in the essentials of a contract, because there is no contract without consideration, subject to some exception. Consideration in general, it is the benefit which moves from one party to another. In any agreement, there is a consideration which moves from one party to another. It may be a cash, it may be kind, anything, or it may be an act, doing or not doing something, services like this. All these are treated as consideration. Let us look at the definition on consideration. According to Pollock, consideration is the price for which promise of the other is bought. Consideration is the price given to the promise of the other. For example, A promised to sell his motor vehicle to B, and for that B is paying rupees 10,000. That is treated as a consideration. So consideration may be cash or kind, which moves from one party to another, which is both sided. According to section 2, subsection D of Indian Contract Act, consideration as when at the desire of promisor, the promisee or any other person has done or abstained from doing or does or abstain from doing or promises to do or abstain from doing something, such an act or abstinence or promise is called a consideration for the promise. Let us look at the definition in detail, the various terms given in the definition. The number one, consideration may be an act or abstinence. That means it is an act doing something. A agrees to sell his house to B. A is selling house, doing something. Abstinence, not doing something. C is the creditor not taking legal action against B for recovery of loan if B promised to pay higher interest. So that is abstinence. So consideration may be doing something or not doing something. Such act or abstinence should be done at the desire of promisor. So this act doing or not doing should be done at the desire of promisor. Suppose he requested B for construction of house, then the construction of house done as per the requirement of A, not at the request of or as per the requirement of other person. Point number three, such act or abstinence done by promisee or any other person. As per Indian law, the act or abstinence done by promisee or any other person can fulfill this on behalf of promisee. Next point, such act might have been already done or being done at the time of formation of contract or may be done in future. So we consider it as past consideration, present consideration and future consideration. Past consideration, which is already done, that is called past consideration. Being done, the work being done, called present consideration. If it is this to be completed in future, that is called future consideration. We'll study about these points in the next concepts. Let us study the legal rules for a valid consideration. It is an important topic in the chapter consideration. There are 12 marks as well as 24 marks questions on this topic along with the Q case laws. Number one, consideration must move at the desire of promisor. That means it must be done. It may be work or service, an act must be done at the request as per the requirement of promisor, but not at the request of other person. For a valid consideration, it must be moved, that means done at the request of promisor. It may be for the benefit of promisor or any other person. There are two examples to understand this concept in a better way. Number one, A sees B's house on fire and helps him in extinguishing it. In this case, A cannot demand payment for his services because B never asked him to help. This act is not treated as consideration because here it is not done at the request of the party. So it is not considered as a consideration. See the second example. B requests his friend A to extinguish the fire. Subsequently, B promises A to pay rupees 200. So this is a valid consideration. So it is done. The work act done at the request of the promisor. There is a case law supporting this topic called Durga Prasad versus Baldew. In this case, Durga Prasad built a market at the desire of the collector of district. The shops were occupied by many shopkeepers who promised to pay money, that is commission, to Durga Prasad. One of the shopkeeper by name Baldew failed to fulfill his promise, so Durga Prasad filed suit against him. It was held by the court that the promise of Baldew could not be enforced against him because Durga Prasad constructed the market at the request of collector of district and not at the request of Baldew. So in this case, the agreement is made between the district collector and Durga Prasad. So Durga Prasad constructed a market at the request of district collector and not at the request of Baldew. So he can enforce the contract against the district collector, not against Baldew. So in this agreement, it was held that the Baldew's promise could not be enforced against him because the work done not at the request of the party but at the request of other person, that is collector of district. Point number two, consideration may move from promisee or any other person. Under Indian law, consideration may move from promisee, paid by promisee or any other person. That is even stranger to consideration. That means the person who has not paid the consideration also can sue contract or can take legal action against the party. Let us study this concept with the help of example. In a contract between A, B and C, A pays rupees 500 to B for delivering one bag of sugar to C. This contract can be enforced by C against B even though C has not paid the consideration. So in this contract, C is the stranger to consideration. C is not giving anything. Even though he is a stranger to consideration, he is a party to contract. He could enforce the contract. The similar cases are studied in one of the case law called Chinnaya versus Ramaya. In this case, A agreed to transfer her property to her daughter through gift deed on the condition that daughter must pay annuity to his brother. And daughter executed a separate deed in favor of her maternal uncle, agreeing to pay the annuity. Later, she refused to pay the annuity on the ground that no consideration had been moved from maternal uncle. But it was held by the court that even though he was stranger to consideration, as the party to contract, could enforce the contract. So in this case law, we understood that the person, even though he is stranger, not paid any consideration, if he is a party to contract, he could enforce the contract. He can take legal action in case any default if he didn't get his claim. Point number 3, consideration may be past, present or future. In case of past consideration, a person promises to pay something for the services already done. For example, A has given tuition to B's son. After 2 months, B promised to pay rupees 2000 to A. So this is a valid consideration as per Indian law. Present consideration, which moves along with the promises. All cash transactions are example. A goes to shop and purchases notebook and pay the amount. So in this case, consideration moved from one party to another simultaneously at the time of promise. A pay the amount and the shopkeeper deliver the goods. In case of future consideration, there are exchange of promises. The obligation will be fulfilled in future. For example, A ordered for the supply of goods in the next week, and B, the supplier, also promised to deliver the goods in the next week. In this case, obligation from both party are pending, that means it to perform in future. That is called future consideration. Point number 4, consideration need not be adequate, but it must be something of value in the eyes of law. In this case, law will not compel particular amount of consideration. There is no specification about the amount of consideration for particular transaction. Suppose A is going to sell his house worth rupees 25 lakhs to B for rupees 5 lakhs. This is a valid consideration when both the party has no objections. But it must be something of value in the eyes of law. Point number 5. Consideration may be positive or negative. Positive consideration is doing something, giving something, services, etc. For example, in agreement between A and B, A agrees to repair the TV of B and B agrees to pay the amount. A positive consideration. In case of negative consideration, which includes not doing something. For example, C, the creditor, agreed to not to take legal action against B for the recovery of loan. So in this case, not taking legal action is a negative consideration. Point number 6, consideration must be real and not illusory, impossible or uncertain. So consideration must be physically or legally possible one. An impossible act, it may be physically or legally, it should not be treated as valid consideration. For example, A agrees to run 100 kilometers per hour for certain amount. This agreement made with the B. So this is not a valid consideration because completion of 100 kilometers per hour is impossible act. Point number 7, consideration must not be illegal or unlawful. It is illegal if it is forbidden by law. Means if it is prohibited by law. For example, sale of smuggled goods. This is buying, selling of smuggled goods is forbidden by law. If it would defeat provision of law. That means marriage, child marriage. Here, which is against the Child Marriage Restraint Act. If it is fraudulent, any agreement to cheat the person. For example, A and B make agreement to cheat C. So, such agreement, the consideration is considered illegal or unlawful. If it is immoral, immoral means the act which is against the good moral of the society. For example, agreement between the party to separate husband and wife, or agreement where a person financially support husband to get divorce from wife. Such act is treated as immoral and the consideration is illegal. And consideration is illegal if it is opposed to public policy. For example, agreement to provide a job in a government office for certain consideration, or agreement to sell the reward, etc., also considered as an agreement opposed to public policy. So, these are the rules for valid consideration. Usually, there are 12 marks or 24 marks on this topic along with the case studies. Let us look at the concept no consideration, no contract, or a contract without consideration is void. It is very clear that consideration is essential element of any contract. Without consideration, a contract is treated as void. But there are exceptions where even though consideration not moved from one of the party, contract is treated as valid. Let us look at these exceptions. Number one, contract arising out of natural love and affection. So, there is natural love and affection between family members, husband and wife, or grandfather and grandson, granddaughter, or grandmother and grandson, granddaughter, etc. There are family relatives where there is a natural love and affection. In case any agreement made between these family members, such agreement, if it is no consideration moved from one of the party, then also it is treated as valid. For example, out of natural love and affection, husband wanted to share certain part of his property with the wife. So, this is valid contract provided it is in writing and registered. And here one thing you have to remember, that there is no natural love and affection during the time of quarrel. Law will not presume natural love and affection during quarrel, and if any agreement made during quarrel, it is not considered as valid. Point number two, promise made to compensate past voluntary services. If a person promises to pay something to another person for his any voluntary service done in the past, that is valid contract even though nothing is moved from one of the party. For example, A saved B's son from danger of fire. After some time, B promised to pay rupees 5000 to A. This is a valid contract even though nothing is moved from one of the party. Point number three, promise to pay time barred debt. A debt or short term loan become time barred if it is not recovered within 3 years from the due date. A time barred debt cannot be recovered from the debtor, but debtor can make agreement to pay the loan. can make separate agreement, but it should be in writing. So in this case, debtor promised to pay the loan, but creditor not paying anything, even though nothing is moved from the party. It is a valid contract. Point number 4, completed gift, that is gift which is actually made. So this is valid when it is in writing and registered. Point number 5, promise to contribute charity. In this case, if a person promised to contribute for something and based on which the other party has taken some monetary liability, in such cases, so that is a valid contract. Point number 6, contract of agency. It's a contract where one party called agent agrees to work for another party called principal as per instruction for certain commission. But at the time of entering agreement between the party, there is no consideration moved from one party to another. Point number 7, compromising or remission of a due debt and extending the time for performance of a contract by promisee. If there is agreement between debtor and creditor where creditor gives extension of time for the repayment of loan, etc., in such a case also, there is no movement of consideration by one of the party, but it is a valid contract. So these are exceptions to the concept no consideration, no contract, and usually there are 12 marks question on this topic. Let us look at another important concept, privity of contract. Or a stranger to contract cannot sue. The principles of privity of contract states that unless a person is a party to contract, he cannot derive any right under it. As per this principle, contract cannot be enforced, can be enforced only by a person who is a party to it. Suppose there is agreement between A and B. A agrees to sell his mobile to B and B promised to pay amount rupees 2000. If B failed to pay the amount, A only can take legal action. He has a right. And any other person, C or D, so such persons cannot take any legal action against the party. So only two persons who are party to contract can take legal action in case of any losses. And C is treated as a third person or a stranger to the contract, who is not related to contract. So he cannot take or enforce the contract. But there are exceptions where stranger to contract also take legal action or enforce the contract. Exception number 1, where there is express or implied trust is created. Trust is the organization which is meant for the management of particular property assets which belongs to others. Trustees are managing the property which belongs to others. In case trust created in favor of the person, for example, a trust created in favor of a minor, for example, A. In such a cases, A, even though he is not a party to contract, he is a beneficiary from that trust. He can enforce the contract. Point number 2, where a charge is created on some specific immovable property for the benefit of third party. In such cases, also third party can take legal action or enforce the contract. There is 6th law called Khwaja Muhammad versus Husseini Begum. Under this case, A, the father of bridegroom, agreed with B, the father of bride, that he would pay rupees 500 per month to the bride if
she married his son. A created a charge on some specific immovable property in favor of the bride for the payment of amount. Marriage was duly performed, but later husband and wife got separated due to quarrel. Father-in-law did not pay the amount as agreed upon. So, the daughter-in-law sued her father-in-law for the payment. It was held by the court that daughter-in-law was entitled to sue upon the contract, though she was a stranger to contract of marriage settlement. Since a charge had been created on some specific immovable property, she could enforce the contract.
Point number 3. Where a provision is made in a marriage settlement, partition arrangement or any other family arrangement for the benefit of third party. In such a cases, third party is eligible to claim his share even though he is not a party to contract. For example, during partition, division of property, certain amount is kept for the marriage of a girl child or for the benefit of a old aged member of the family. In such a cases, they can claim their share even though they are not the part of contract. Point number 4. Where there is an assignment of rights under contract in favor of third party, even though he is not a party to contract, based on the rights assigned to him, he can enforce a contract. Point number 5. When a contract is entered through an agent. In case of agency, suppose A is the agent of B. He agree with the dealings with the C on behalf of the principal. In this case, B, the principal, even though he is not involved in the transaction directly, he can enforce the contract because the contract entered into by the agent on behalf of principal. So principal has the right to enforce the contract. Point number 6. When the defendant or promisor constitute himself as an agent of third party, either by conduct or by estoppel. Let us look at the point with the help of example. If A receives some money from B to be paid over to C, and A admit this receipt to C, then C can recover this amount from A, who shall be regarded as agent of B. So these are the exceptions to privity of contract. Usually there are 12 marks question on privity of contract.